This is the What a Day podcast with your host, Joe What a Day Lowry. Hey everybody, Joe Lowry, what a day, and it is my pleasure to have with us today a former NWA World's Women Champion. She is also a former two-time Impact Knockouts Champion, and of course, I'm talking about the beautiful and talented Allysin. Allysin, welcome to the show.
Hey Joe, what a day. Thank you for having me.
No problem, no problem. Now, real quickly, I know you've been around for years, you've been in the indie circuit and so forth, you're a world traveler. But I first caught a glimpse of you back in 2018 at the Mae Young Classic with the WWE. Can you tell us your experience with that?
Yeah, I had a great time at the Classic. I feel like I really walked into the perfect scenario for me, or the perfect point in my career, rather, because I walked into a locker room of girls that I mostly already knew. Right. And the ones that I didn't know were completely charming. So I had a great experience there.
Excellent. Excellent. And I noticed that you've been most notable 2017 Pro Wrestling Illustrated top 50 women's wrestlers. You came in at number 8. I know you've charted since then. How did it feel to get that exposure?
It was great. I mean, it's all glad to be featured. I enjoy reading it every year. I know fans and promoters alike really love the PWI. And I think this year I came in either 20 or 25.
Okay.
And I even felt like I was surprised, because during their evaluation period, I didn't think I was wrestling that much, but I was NWA Women's World Champion, I believe, during that period. So it's, of course, always nice to be recognized. And right. The year that you're speaking of, where I was number 8, I believe, I was 2-time Knockouts Champion. And I believe, I could be wrong, so don't quote me, but I believe I was the only non-WWE woman featured in the top 10.
Wow, that's very impressive. That is impressive. Now, I like to ask my guests this question. How did you become a fan of wrestling, and what made you become a professional wrestler?
I watched wrestling ever since I was a kid. It seems like it's either or with wrestlers, you know, either you watched it as a kid or you just got into it as an adult for whatever reason.
Right.
But I watched it with my father. So I wish I could remember like exactly what we were watching, but I just have like this vague memory of laying on the living room floor with him watching wrestling. It would have been like early 90s. Wow. And then my peak obsession with wrestling was like 98, 99. Oh, wow. The Attitude Era. That's when my siblings and I became obsessed.
Wow. Yeah, I took my son to WrestleMania 14, 1998 at the Fleet Center in Boston, and the Undertaker entrance, he was only 6 years old at the time, but that's all he remembers when he was a kid. Undertaker's entrance, WrestleMania 14. So the Attitude Era, big era back then. I know Road Dogg was a big proponent of that. I think you have some type of affiliation with Brian.
Not affiliation, but I wrote, I just posted to Instagram not too long ago.
That's what it was. Okay.
Yeah, a seventh grade picture of mine where I'm wearing a custom made Road Dogg necklace. Like I made it out of beads.
Oh, wow.
Because that was my guy when I was 12. I was like, yes, wow. Road Dogg. He's very charismatic. I was very drawn to that. So he was one of my favorites.
Right. Now, you've with the Attitude Era, your parents let you watch that era, even though you were, what, 11 or 12?
It was a controversial topic in my household. We were told several times, I'm not letting you watch this anymore, by my mother. I forget which pay-per-view it was, but we would always beg to get the pay-per-views. And when they were like $25, my mom would get them, and then they kept increasing. And she's like,
oh, yeah, they were going up. Yep.
Yeah. When they were like $20, $25, we could kind of convince her to do it.
Yep.
And there was one pay-per-view. I want to say it was a Royal Rumble, but I could be wrong. Miss Kitty was wrestling in some type of liquid. I don't know. Yep. Gravy. I don't know what it was.
I think it was a pudding match.
So it was something where they were in a pool.
Yep.
And at the end of the match, she takes her bra off anyway.
Yep.
And of course, my mom walks into the living room right at that moment.
Oh, my goodness.
I'm not letting you watch this anyway. And I'm just really, no, it's not like this all the time. I swear. Yeah.
I think Sergeant Slaughter had a hand in that. He actually came in and covered her up because she was laughing, and they covered her up. So all that. Those are good times.
I mean, I definitely, my mom would constantly threaten to not let us watch wrestling anymore, but we somehow would like be able to. We'd like convince her. I remember one time like trying to, my very first wrestling magazine. It was like my first Raw magazine when they had Raw and then SmackDown. Oh, yeah. Or on SmackDown. They had Raw and WWE E! Magazine. The very first one that I ever got had Sable on the cover, where she's wearing the leather bra and she has the women's championship like across her
lower.
I have to beg my mom at the grocery store to buy me that magazine. She's like, I'm not buying you this. And I'm just like, look, I'm like flipping through all the pages. And I was like, there's nothing in here. And they had a big Road Dog section or article. I think it was when I just remember he was all bloody. And I'm like, there's Road Dog in it. And I'm like begging her to buy it. And I was like, she looked through the bad magazine. But right after Road Dog, feature, I really did miss the two pages where Sable's like in a lake with like a white t-shirt all wet. And I just didn't enjoy that part.
Yeah, and of course they transcended into the Playboy stuff and all that stuff afterwards. It was hard because my son loved it, and I would have to convince everybody else in the family it's just entertainment. That's all it is. And you see the warnings coming on before Raw and SmackDown, and don't try this at home. And but I'm out in the backyard with my son, anyways, doing the same thing. So I hear you there. So Japan and Europe, real quickly, what was it like wrestling over there? I know I like to get.
Loved it. My trips to England were always too short. The last time I was there, I was so sick for the most of the time, so I didn't get to do too much. But Japan was one of my favorite experiences. The last time I went was for a week, but I crammed in as much as I could during that week. And my first experience there was for 3 months. So I got to do a lot there, build a lot of lasting relationships. Nice. And it's probably my first trip to Japan is probably like in my top three experiences in wrestling.
Now, do you see a difference in the wrestling over there compared to over here? I've heard so many stories. Whether it's the crowds or the style of wrestling, did you encounter that when you were over there?
Yeah, the style is definitely different. The crowds as well. Everyone, the stereotype is that the Japanese crowds are very silent. They're not always silent, though. Like when you're there, they get rowdy sometimes. Yeah. I think it just depends on the show and it depends on the match, I guess. But they get loud, even at like the bigger events that I attended while I was there.
It's funny how you talk about the wrestling magazine. When I was growing up in the 80s, they would do some feature articles on Japanese, and the crowds were, they always looked in the pictures, very chaotic, celebratory, like, you know. And then I heard later on that sometimes they're quiet. I'm like, I've never seen that. So
I've seen both.
Yeah. Really? Oh, that's cool. Any famous arenas you wrestled in over there, or was it?
I don't recall. I don't believe so.
Okay. Yeah, that's cool. Awesome. Awesome. Now, the pandemic, obviously, it's affected everybody. It's really affected the wrestling industry. How are you coping with the pandemic on a professional level and so forth with wrestling and all that?
I mean, I'm doing what I can. Wrestling for me started back in September. And it's definitely different. The no crowd, I did a no crowd show, which was okay because the commentators really saved that experience. Right. You know, I had commentators in the background and the production was high on that show.
Right.
So that kind of made up for it. But I don't know, it is definitely, it's just different. Even the ones that have crowds, the crowds are like, you know, a little lighter than they normally would be.
Sure. Oh yeah, understandable.
I think that's the biggest thing that has affected the wrestling is feeling there's like a different dynamic, a different vibe in the crowd sometimes.
Right.
And then of course traveling is very different.
Of course.
But even then, I don't know. Like I kind of like flying on Delta now because they're not selling the middle seat and I'm
kind of good. Oh, there you go. That's always a plus. I hate the middle seat. That's for sure. Now, with, you know, obviously with the light crowds and so forth, do you watch wrestling on, like you watch SmackDown or Raw or Impact? And is it easy for you to watch or hard with the no crowds?
I think it's different. Like I remember when the pandemic first started watching WrestleMania, and that was very weird.
Yeah, it was brutal.
Of course, it didn't feel like WrestleMania. That was like the one that I noticed the most because you have a certain expectation for what WrestleMania will feel like with the crowd and stuff, even when you're just watching on TV. But no, watching otherwise, I think I'm already used to it kind of.
Yeah.
Like wrestling in front of that atmosphere, I'm not a fan of because I vibe with the crowd so much. I feed off the crowd. I sometimes change what I do in the ring based off the crowd. So if I don't have that reaction, it's just not as enjoyable to me. I can get through it, but it's not as enjoyable. So I can only imagine how. I mean, right now they have at least the screens. So they at least are having some audio to feed off of a little bit.
And they get the fake noise pumped in, like all the football crowds are doing now and everything like that. So
the no audience at all, the silence is rough. People say, oh, it's like a custom match, if anyone's familiar with custom matches, but yeah. Not because there are much lower expectations than a customs match.
I mean, you're supposed to feed off the crowd and, you know, get their reaction, whether negative or positive. And when you don't have that, so you don't know if anything's going right. So I get you there. It's funny we talk about the no crowds and so forth, because it was last year during the pandemic, I caught a glimpse of Jordan Grace versus Deonna Purrazzo when Deonna won the Knockouts Championship. And I had Jordan on over the summer, and I had to tell her, I go, you know, when I watched that night, I was always scrolling through my phone or doing whatever and watching in the background. But when they came on and I watched them, they literally beat the hell out of each other. And for 20 minutes, they had my undivided attention. And then we both agreed on when she was on my podcast that you didn't even need a crowd there. They sold that match so well. It was really, really great. It made me a better fan, because I could see that there is a possibility, because it was new then, that two people can get in the ring without a crowd and put on a great show. So,
oh yeah, especially with a high production. So like with the Impact production, like they can definitely work around the no crowd thing for sure.
But they didn't even need the crowd. The moves right. They did and the selling they did, it was like watching. It was almost like they were performing just for you in your house. Mm-hmm. And I always thought everyone should get on board with that. Some people have, some people haven't. They're all trying their tricks and everything, but it is what it is. But do you feel post pandemic, when we're finally, you know, we see the light's at the end of the tunnel somewhere, the new normal, what do you see the new normal? Is it going to be spacious crowds? Are we going to get back to, you know, a packed house? What do you think will happen in the wrestling industry with that?
It's really hard to tell, because I remember a year ago when everyone was like, oh, this will be over by April. It'll be fine. You know what I mean? Like, I don't know. I could see things slowly getting back to what we thought was normal before, but I feel like that is a very far ways away.
Right.
I can see, like, especially with the vaccine, once that's more readily available to everyone, maybe capacity increasing.
Yeah.
But still having to, you know, socially distance and wear masks and things like that. So I can see it slowly getting back to more normal, but not fully.
It depends on the area too. I mean, some regions, Florida is fully open now, but you know, they can't have the big crowds, but that makes a big difference, because AEW, as you know, you've appeared on AEW. What was that like, really quick, being over there?
Oh, it was great. I was thrilled to be in a match with Serena. I love Serena. She's actually who I lived with my first trip in Japan for 3 months. So we've known each other for a long time. It was a great experience. Very similar to when I did the Classic. I know so many people there, so I felt very welcomed.
Awesome, awesome. Any chance of going back to AEW soon, or is that on the radar at all right now?
Everything. There's always a chance for everything.
Speaking of everything, you have a very big match coming up. February 6th, Mission Pro Wrestling. You are getting back in the ring, no stranger to you, and she's no stranger to WhattaDay, because she's been on the show a couple of times, but you have a cage match with Thunder Rosa.
I do.
What are your thoughts on that? What's going on? How did this all come about, this cage match?
Oh, man. Well, as I'm sure you're aware, we have a history together.
Yes, you do.
I just feel like there's something about Thunder Rosa and myself that once we met, like fully met as opponents, I guess I should say, at NWA. I don't know. I don't really know how to put it into words, but like there was like a chemistry there.
Right. Lightning in a bottle, right? Lightning in a bottle, they call it.
Maybe. I feel like we have this like toxic relationship where we are sick of each other, but we can't stay away from each other for some reason.
True.
And I think that it's very poetic that now we can't really get away from each other as easily in this cage match.
Right.
You know, we already had two matches, and I feel like we need to up the ante a little bit. So it was my challenge. It was my idea. I enjoy being in a cage. She's not unfamiliar with being in a cage. And I just felt like I wanted to throw out the challenge. And honestly, I didn't really think she was going to accept. So I'm thrilled that she did. I'm very excited for February 6th.
Well, speaking of Thunder Rosa, she just texted me and she has a message for you. So you can respond after I read this message. Thunder Rosa, Joe, please tell Allysin that I am living the best life and cannot wait to smear her face inside the cage February 6th. Allysin, your response.
Well, I wish her luck. I saw the first time and only time she was ever in a cage, and she wasn't smearing anyone's face anywhere. So she's going to have a tough time doing that. I look forward to it. I have, I've been in three cage matches throughout my career, throughout my life. I've won every single one of them. And that includes my MMA fight. So I am going into this very confident. I know that Rosa has never been in a cage match in pro wrestling. I know she's been in one MMA fight, and I'm sure you're familiar with how that went.
Yeah.
So I'm not worried about it.
No worry about it. Now, February 6th, Mission Pro Wrestling. Where is this going to be held at now?
This is going to be in Buda, Texas.
All righty.
Pinball's Kingdom.
Okay. I've seen the ads on Instagram and so forth. It looks like a strong card there. For a night of wrestling. And I've been on their website, missionprowrestling.net. If anybody gets a chance to check that out, there's some pictures on there and so forth. But, well, that just about wraps it up here, Allysin. I want to thank you for checking in with WhattaDay. Real quickly, before we do say goodbye, do you have any message to your fans? What's upcoming besides the cage match? Anything that you'd like to tell anyone?
I do have some fun projects coming up, but I can't really reveal anything right now. My main focus right now is my cage match against Thunder Rosa. That is my next step. And you can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Sienna, and you can find me on patreon.com/AllysinK.
Excellent. Allysin, I appreciate your time, and I want to thank you again for coming on the WhattaDay show.
Thank you for having me.
All right, everybody. There you have it. Miss Allysin K coming on the WhattaDay show. I'm Joe Lowry. WhattaDay. You have been watching the WhattaDay podcast with Joe Lowry. Follow Joe at WhattaDay Joe on all social media platforms. Thanks for watching.